We're picking up chapter 3 of 1 Timothy at verse 8. Now, the beginning of the chapter discussed the qualifications for the overseers of the church, the pastors. The word bishop is used here in the Bible, the idea of the overseers, the elders. And as we get into verse 8 now, we're going to see some material that's very similar, but talking about a different category of leadership, and that is the deacon. And so we will see some contrast and some similarities. So let's jump in at verse 8. Likewise, deacons must be reverent, not double-tongued, not given to much wine, not greedy for money, holding the mystery of the faith with a pure conscience. But let these also first be tested, then let them serve as deacons, being found blameless. So a lot of familiarity, and we're not going to repeat everything we've said in the prior 2 weeks about some of these things about not being greedy for money or given to much wine and so forth. The one noticeable difference is there's no reference to the deacons as being able to teach. That was a big part of the pastoral qualifications, and it's a big part of pastoral ministry. Now, here at our church, we do not have the title pastor thrown around for what really, I believe, biblically are the deacons. I know a lot of churches, you go to their website, and they've got 25 pastors listed, but the titles are like, well, this is the worship pastor, this is the audiovisual pastor, and this is the children's pastor, or whatever, and the different ministries of the church, and the leaders are known as pastors, and yet I think that might be a little off in terms of how the Bible would set it up for us. A big part of pastoral ministry is teaching. Now, of course, it's also having to do with the oversight of the church, in terms of the running of the church and all the rest of it. And the teaching does not have to be, you know, formal pulpit teaching on Sundays, which is typically, you know, one guy who does that unless he's sick or out of town. But the deacons is a different category because, again, we're talking about the servant leaders of the church. But there's a variety of aspects to service in the local church. But what I want you to see is that the characteristics of their character remains the same, doesn't it? So you say, well, a pastor really has to have a godly character or else he really needs to step down. We've emphasized that for the last couple of weeks. But there's no Bible that says, oh, but the deacons, they can be, you know, a bunch of screw-offs. I mean, it doesn't really matter much about them. I mean, they're just deacons after all. No, no, no. Are you kidding me? You're serving in the local church. That godly character is still very, very important. Now, there's 2 points I want to bring out, though, before we leave this little section. Verse 10 speaks about being tested, you know, serving and proving themselves. I think that's wise counsel. Obviously, it is. It's in the Bible. I shouldn't have to say that. But I have seen it not show itself in other circumstances, not here. But I know that there are times when the local church, which has a lot of needs, and all churches have their needs, and someone new comes to the fellowship, and this person is a real mature Christian who, you know, knows their theology good and wants to help and is excited and all the rest of it, and boom, we just plug them in. You know, they've been there for 3 Sundays and now they're all of a sudden in charge of some ministry. And I think that's really going against what this verse is telling us. Now, we don't know what sort of testing is involved. I mean, I don't think there's some formal written exam that needs to be administered. But how it works out practically here at our fellowship, as many of you may know, we ask when someone comes to visit, no matter how excited they are about possibly serving and all, and they read the needs, they see them in the bulletin, they hear us announce something, we say, you know what, for the first 6 months, just come and worship God. Don't even think about that. Just come and worship God for 6 months. No matter how bad our needs are, God will take care of them, but you worship God for 6 months. Why? Because God guides His sheep. And God will speak to the hearts of individuals. And during that time, any sort of initial emotion or excitement about something new, 6 months, not some magical number, but it's enough time that God will speak to the heart about, you know what, this is home for me. I'm gonna plant here. As opposed to like, I don't know, you know, I it was good the first couple weeks, but I'm not really agreeing with some of the stuff I hear or some of the stuff I see. Okay, God will guide his sheep. And so for 6 months, there's no pressure. And that's the opportunity not only for the people to get to know the church, but the church leadership to get to know the people. And as Jesus said, you know, you begin to be faithful in the little things, and then greater things are entrusted. So even once someone does step out to serve, there's a time where the leadership role will expand over time and over faithfulness. So that's the first point there in verse 10. The other thing I want to note is in verse 9, that word mystery, holding the mystery of the faith. Now, maybe 50, 100 years ago, I wouldn't need to add this little disclaimer, but I do today, and the reason is because the word mystery has had a change of meaning in our society. From what it used to mean in English, and it's the same word in Greek. There's no big Greek-English mystery here, but did you catch that? I didn't mean to do that. But it just shows how prevalent it is, because here's my point. We use the word mystery as something that is unknown, right? It's a confusion, it's a question. Where did I leave my car keys? It's a mystery. And just like I said a moment ago, there's no Greek-English mystery as if something that can't be figured out. But that's not what the word means either in the Greek 2,000 years ago or what it used to mean in our English language as well. We speak of a mystery novel or a mystery movie. They've been around for a long time. And you know what they have in common is the beginning, there's a question. There's confusion. You know, who did the crime or whatever. But then by the time you get to the end, you find out the answer. It's revealed what the question was all along. Now we can come to a nice conclusion. That, by definition, was a mystery novel or movie. But the way our society has changed so much, we now use the word mystery as some sort of a question mark. Well, I guess we'll never figure it out. And that has also shown itself in our culture and in the arts. Because now, isn't it common that you have a lot of movies and stuff where you invest your $12 in an hour and a half or whatever, and you get to the end, you feel ripped off because the thing closes and the credits are running, you don't know who did it. What did I sit through this for? And it speaks to the whole postmodern existential sort of mindset that's gone on over the decades. Like, well, what do you think would be the good ending? We don't want to, you know, you can decide that, you know, this person did it. You can decide that person did it. You can decide that it never happened at all. And you know, and people come up with their own opinions. And that's more and more common, is it? And it's lumped under the word mystery. Now, why am I saying all this? Because you read the Bible say the word mystery in several places like here. But a mystery is not some question mark, not some unsolvable, confusing point. A mystery is something, yes, that was hidden, but has now been revealed. You see, that's the key. The Christian faith has been revealed to the world. God has done that. God does not want people around the world scratching their heads going, I wonder if the Muslims have it right, or maybe the Hindus, I don't know, and that Buddhist stuff is kind of interesting. God has revealed what, no doubt, in the Old Testament era in the past was somewhat hidden. Even the prophets weren't entirely sure what they were writing about. But now it's been revealed. So every time you read the word mystery, you say, mystery of the faith. Does that mean the deacons have these special insights that regular Christians can't possibly understand? No, but they are doctrinally sound. They hold to the truth. What has been revealed by God. It's very important. Now, verse 11, we have some controversy. There are basically two groups for interpreting verse 11. And unfortunately, our New King James translation has added something that implies that one group is correct. And it's the group I disagree with, so that's why I say unfortunately. And that's verse 11. Let's look at it. Likewise, notice, their wives must be reverent, not slanderers, temperate, faithful in all things. Now you notice the word "there" is in italics. When you read a word in italics in your Bible, you know that the translators added it to aid in the translation. It's always challenging to go from one language to another. We use the expression, it was lost in the translation. And so sometimes you have to add a few words of clarification so you can get the point across as you move from one language to another. And the Bible does that. But the Bible translators have deliberately put words in italics to say, look, this is us inserting something to help the flow. But here they've inserted a word that is not in the Bible text. And in doing so, as I said, they have picked a side in the debate. Because by saying their wives, the implication is this is talking about the wives of the deacons, isn't it? I don't think it's talking about the wives of the deacons at all. Why would it be necessary for the wives of the men serving in the church to have this godly character? Now, I can see that there could be some answers. Well, of course it'd be important, but here's my question. If it's so important, then why on earth is there not a verse talking about the wives of the pastors in the prior verses, you see? No, this is not their wives, speaking of the deacons. What this is referring to, I believe, and I join that second group, is talking about the women servants of the church. The Bible tells us that women have and should continue to serve in the local church. Starting in the book of Acts, you read Paul's letters, you see women very influential and important and fundamental in the service and the effectual working of the local church. There is no Greek word for deaconesses like we might say today. So the word here, wives, without the there, there's no reference back. And of course, being married was very common. But it's talking about the women servants of the church, I believe. And of course, they have to have some godly character as well. And it's appropriate for women to serve in the church. Women serve at this church. We're thankful for their service. We need it so greatly. So if you put it all together, you see what God's word has done here. On the one hand, we have the pastoral office, which, as we saw earlier, and I'm not going to reteach it today, is an office for the men, which involves the teaching ministry, at least in part, if not in full. Then, though, you have other servants in the local church, both men and women, and we call them deacons and deaconesses. And all three groups require a godly character, or you shouldn't be there. This is one of the challenges in living the Christian life. How many times do you ask yourself, it's something going on in life, am I hearing from God in His Spirit, or am I hearing from Satan? Am I getting conviction from God's Spirit, or am I getting condemnation from my spiritual enemy? Right? It's a very real part of living the Christian life. So when it comes to serving in the local church, I just say this. We recognize that if your Christian walk personally is a train wreck, then you really need to step down from service, right? Or at least not choose to volunteer. Get your personal walk with Jesus right first. That's the priority. And any leadership of a church will say, you know, the priority is you, not the needs, you. And so maybe God is speaking to someone's heart about, you know what, I just get some things in order. I need to step down from here. I shouldn't be doing this. And of course, if God's speaking to someone's heart, you want fully supportive and say amen. But I say this out of years of observation in the lives of others. We have a spiritual enemy. And the last thing he wants is someone serving at the local church and making it stronger and more effective and doing things. And so he might be there trying to tempt people to step down too. And what I have seen in the past is it is very easy when someone steps down from that commitment, the commitment that's been keeping them going and keeping them helping and keeping them serving, to then kind of drift. Stop going to church at all. Stop reading their Bible. Stop praying. Next thing you know, it's like, are you even in fellowship anywhere? I mean, what's going on, man? I mean, you were serving at the church and you're a faithful Christian. It was such a great witness and all that. And now it's like you're just out there in the world. I can't even tell you're a believer or not. Happens like a slippery slope. So that's why I say the difference is Satan trying to tempt you to get you going down the wrong path, or is God properly convicting and saying, no, just for a season, get your own house in order. It must be something that the person works out with God, because the church is not going to send a bunch of, you know, secret police to spy out your emails and your home life and all that kind of stuff, you know. It's the last thing we're going to do. Now, we're still on this general topic here, so we continue on talking about deacons, deaconesses. Verse 12, let deacons be the husbands of one wife, ruling their children and their own house as well. The inclusion of that might be what leads some people to read verse 11 improperly, thinking it's about deacons' wives. For those who have served well as deacons obtain for themselves a good standing and a great boldness in the faith, which is in Christ Jesus. It is great to serve the Lord. Now, we talk about serving the Lord in a variety of ways, just as part of your life. You know, getting up and working a job and making a paycheck to feed your family. That's part of serving the Lord. But here, of course, we're talking about in the more specific realm of serving Christ in the work of the local church ministry. That's the context. And it is a blessing. Now, to finish the chapter, Paul writes, verse 14, these things I write to you, though I hope to come to you shortly, but if I am delayed, I write so you may know how you ought to conduct yourself in the house of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and ground of the truth. So Paul saying, I want to be there with you, Timothy. I know I'm asking a lot of you. You're trying to straighten out the problems there at the church in Ephesus with the elders and the leadership and the deacons, no doubt, and all these issues. And I'll get there when I can, but if I'm not there, you got my letter. And the letter will instruct to conduct yourself in the house of God, which is the church of the living God. It's important when we read the word house that we recognize that often in the Bible, house implies household, the people. Sometimes you read, you know, Peter and all his house went somewhere. So it's not Peter and he's grabbing the lumber and the roof. And it's talking about, you know, the wife and the kids, right? The household. And the Greek word, just the context depends. Are you talking about the actual structure or are you talking about the people? Now that, of course, makes sense when you think about the word church. Because probably you are aware that in the Bible, church is talking about the people. Amen? We are the church. Not the building. Not the meeting place. Not the geographic spot. The people are the church. The word speaks to a called out assembly. And so the people are the church. We recognize that, again, in our normal communication, we can't reinvent the wheel at this stage, and so it'll still be said sometimes, hey, we got to paint the church on Saturday. We're not asking you all to line up in front of us in, you know, raincoats or something while we get a paintbrush over your face. We all know what we're talking about, don't we? But we do need to remember that the church is the people, not the place. How do you behave there amongst the fellowship, the house of God, the household of God? And then it's described as the pillar and the ground or the foundation of the truth. The truth. Now, there are people today, the atheists, the humanists, maybe other religions, who do not see the authority of the Bible, and they say stuff like, well, you know, the church created the Bible. That's just flat out wrong. Sadly, I know some Christians, depending on their denominational tradition, that almost enforce that view as they basically say, well, the church has the last word of interpretation on the Bible. In other words, here's what the church says, and the church has the authority when it comes to the scriptures. The reason I'm talking about the Bible is because I'm talking about truth. And the truth is found in the Word of God. The written Word of God, the Scriptures, and of course, the living Word of God, Jesus Christ. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. Referencing Jesus Christ there in the opening of John's Gospel, and Jesus himself would tell us later, I am the way and the truth and the life. The truth is found in the Word of God, both the living Lord Jesus and the written Scriptures. Thy Word is truth. Now, the question comes very simply. Which came first, the Word or the Christian? And the answer is, of course, the Word. Faith comes by hearing, hearing by the Word of God. One does not become a Christian until one has been born again through belief in the Word of God and the working of the living Word of God in the heart of that person. Amen? The Word is primary. So how wrong it is to think that somehow the church made a decision about the Word. Now, I know there were councils and conferences in early church history, and I know there were early debates about some of the books of the Bible, although a lot of times those debates are really exaggerated by the enemies of Christianity. But there's no doubt that there was some discussion about some things, as to whether they had the apostolic authority to be the Word of God. But if we think, the way it's portrayed, that a bunch of, you know, priests showed up in a room one day, it's, all right, guys, show of hands, 2 Peter, we keeping that one? All right, that one's in. We got a majority on that. Now, how about that Shepherd of Hermes one? No, that one, okay, that one's out. That is not at all how our Bible came into being. Don't you believe any suggestion along those lines? I think it's proper to say, because the truth does come first, the Word comes first, it is proper to say that the church discovered God's Word. God gave His Word through the process of inspiration using human instruments. Men of God. The men were not inspired. The scriptures are inspired. All scripture is inspired. You say, what's the difference? I don't get it. Well, let's look at someone like James, for example. He wrote the book of James, the one book we have in the Bible that was attributed to James. Does anyone think that's the only thing James ever wrote in his entire life? That he never wrote any letters to Christians or a love letter to his wife or a grocery shopping list when he went to the Jerusalem Target or whatever. I mean, you see, but if you say that the man is inspired, then everything he writes, right, is some godly inspiration. But that's not what the Bible teaches, and it's not what we believe. But James sits down, and the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, a process, is active upon James, and he writes so that every word of that one letter is the inspired Word of God and the truth. And God worked through James that one time as his instrument. Use Luke twice. Luke and Acts. Use John 5 times, right? The Gospel, the Revelation, and the 3 epistles. Paul, more times than that. But even with Paul, we even have internally Paul referencing letters that he wrote that are not part of the Scripture. People say, oh, we got some lost Bible. No, we don't. God preserves His Word. We have all the Scripture that God wants us to have. And of course, if you think back in early church history, or think hypothetically of today, what if there was a crime right now where it flat out said, we are going to take you from your family and throw you in jail and sentence you to death for possession of a Bible? Would any of you get rid of your Bibles? Because I sure wouldn't. Now, what happens if that law was written in very broad, general terms to just include any religious literature?
Well, I'd still hold on to my Bible, but some of the books I have for research purposes, like the Book of Mormon or the Quran or whatever, they'd go in the trash because I'm not going to be separated from my family for a lie. I just have those for research purposes. I'm not holding on to those as the Word of God. You see the difference there? Put yourself back in the early centuries of the church when the same thing actually was happening. And if you held on to a manuscript from Paul or John or Luke or whatever, it might mean you go to jail. It might mean you give your life. You're going to not worry about those other writings that might be old and might have some Jesus references, you know, Gospel of Thomas and some of that other stuff that you hear floating around out there, because that's not the Word of God. And then over time, finally, yes, there was the canon of Scripture. The church did not create it. The church discovered it. God gave it. The truth comes first. The church, described here as the pillar and foundation of the truth, is not saying that the church has the authority on the truth. It's saying that the truth is found in the church. And God help us when people can go to church and think, I'm going to go to a Christian church today, and they don't hear any truth. They get a feel-good, pick-me-up, motivational message, or even worse, they get flat-out heresy, lies. Well, you know, Jesus really wants us to do that, and God really thinks this. And it's not the truth. And that's why when we come to the house of God, and again, the church, the people, the household, we are here to listen to the truth, to read the truth, to proclaim the truth. And the truth is found in the local church. It's not saying that some church has the monopoly of interpretation and what the priest said 1,500 years ago stands today and don't you dare question it. But we do recognize, don't we, that there are Christian churches, truly Christian churches, that have some differences of opinion on different teachings. And yet we accept and receive those churches as brothers and sisters in Christ, just like hopefully they better receive us, because we are. Because it comes down to the foundations, the absolute essentials. And that's where we conclude with verse 16. Now, verse 16, you notice how it's set apart in your New King James text and maybe some of your other Bible translations if you're using a different one. Almost all scholars believe this was originally some sort of a hymn or a poem of some sort. In other words, he's quoting something that was kind of already known, a beautiful expression centered on Jesus Christ, as we're going to see. Verse 16, and without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifested in the flesh, justified in the spirit, seen by angels, preached among the Gentiles, believed on in the world, received up in glory. And it really reads in Greek beautifully and structured. There's our word again in verse 16. Without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. Oh, I don't understand godliness. What is godliness? No, the revealed truth. Yes, it may have been hidden, but now in Christ revealed to all, without controversy, godliness is found in Jesus Christ, who is then described. God was manifested in the flesh. Now, I know some translations have, he was manifested in the flesh. And I know you might have heard a Christian or two say, oh, that's those satanic Bible translators, you know, out to undermine the deity of Jesus. No, it's not. It's a manuscript issue. Now, I know in English there's a big difference between God and he. Two different words. They don't even share a common letter. But in Greek, it's not that case at all. God is a four-letter word. He is a two-letter word. The last two letters of the word for God. So if you remove the first two letters of God, you have the word he. And that's what happened in a manuscript or two that began to get copied. And that's why we have two families of manuscripts, one that have God, one that have he. It's not some sinister translator thing to try to undermine Jesus. In fact, even if you let it be he, it's still talking about the incarnation, because it's about Jesus clearly, as the rest of the verses show us. He was manifested in the flesh. He became flesh and dwelt among us. Not just some earthly birth like everybody else. But that is Christianity. If your view of Jesus Christ does not say that he is God who became a human being while remaining God fully and 100%, fully God, fully human. If that is not your Jesus, you are not a Christian church. And all Christian churches will proclaim that that is their Jesus. God in human flesh who walked among us, justified in spirit. Again, there's some debate about what that might mean, but I think we can see that it's certainly talking about the aspects of his life, you know, his victory over all temptation, over all satanic attack, his victory over the cross itself, justified in spirit. He was manifest in flesh, and then in spirit, justified. Seen by angels. You remember the angels there present at the resurrection. Preached among the Gentiles, believed on in the world, and then received up in glory. Jesus ascended to heaven while the disciples looked on, didn't he? See, when we talk about the resurrection of Jesus, I think it's important to remember that he's the first to ever do that. Whenever you see someone who was dead brought back to life by a miracle hand of God, Jesus, for example, raising Lazarus, that guy died again, didn't he? You could say that was a glorified resuscitation. I mean, still a miracle. He was dead, but he went back and died a second time. Jesus rose from the dead never to die again. Bodily resurrection, walking around, having food, eating with the disciples. Now, there's a couple people in the Bible, and there's going to be many in the future, who never saw a physical death, right? God just took them up to heaven. Enoch, Elijah. But that's not what happened to Jesus either. He died and he rose from the grave. And then later, he ascended to heaven. And he promises that one day he will descend in the same way and return. The incarnation, God becoming flesh and dwelling among us, the sinless, victorious life, the death, the resurrection, the ascension of Jesus, the promised return, that's what we proclaim, and that's what needs to believe on in the world. That's the truth. And it's not a hidden secret. It's not a mystery by today's standard in any way. The truth is revealed to us all, and we are responsible. And I hope and pray that all here today are resting in Jesus Christ and his finished work for your sins. He is the truth. It's too important to live with confusion and uncertainty and debate about maybe those other religions have it right. No. God has revealed very clearly through Jesus and his words and his works and through the pages of this book, the Holy Bible, and none other. You don't need another book to explain this book. Read this book and ask God to speak to your heart, and he will, if you are doubting the truth. You read what other people write, I don't know where you're going to go. You read God's word about the living word, the crucified and resurrected and ascended word. That is our Jesus. That is who we proclaim. That is what the churches who are our true brothers and sisters also proclaim. And anyone who does not proclaim that is false. And next week, as we move into chapter 4, we're going to get a glimpse of the sort of stuff that is believed in the last days. So let us pray.